Please stand and remove your hats for our national anthem.
Please remain standing for the invocation, which will be given by Reverend Courtney Nazaire.
Let us pause for a moment of reflection and prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the minds and hearts of those in this room, the drive, the tenacity, the endurance required to finish the season well. Does not go unnoticed. We thank you for the support of professors, friends, and family to reach this point. Public health is a team sport, and we're grateful for those that we were able to lean on. Whether it be global health, epidemiology, health law or policy, urban health, etc., we hope to be a blessing to those around us. May the blood, sweat, and tears be not in vain, but produce long-lasting change in society. May lives be touched because we have said yes to meet the dire needs in our cities, country, and world. We know these needs do not always have simple solutions, but we trust that you will provide the strategy, networks, and compassion to get the job done. We ask that when frustrations rise up, confusion settles in, and funding runs out, to remind us of the bigger picture, that you will always use our yes. May we always be available to try again, to research more, and to rest when needed. As we aim to keep the public healthy, may we not neglect our own health. We ask that you would preserve us in joy, peace, patience, and excitement for the road that lies ahead. Use us to be your hands and feet, and may passion drive us to continue in all circumstances. We thank you for being with us then, now, and later. Amen.
Welcome, and please be seated. Please welcome Dr. Anna Diaz-Rue, Dean of the Dana and David Dornsife School of Public Health and Distinguished University Professor of Epidemiology.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's wonderful to be back in person with you all. I'm thrilled to see all of our students and their friends and families, our faculty, our colleagues, and all of our friends coming together again to congratulate another wonderful graduating class. I am pleased to welcome members of the Dornsife School of Public Health faculty and administration who are assembled here today in the support of the students whom they have taught, mentored, and recommended for academic degrees. I also want to extend a very warm welcome to all the families and friends of our students, and also to other special guests who are joining us today, including the co-chairs of the Dean's Advisory Council, Mary Duden, Jerry Miller, and Marion Wentworth, as well as our keynote speaker, Celine Chapman. Thank you so much for joining us, for accompanying us along our journey, and for coming today as we honor our students. Dear graduating students, congratulations for all that you have learned and accomplished during this truly, truly unprecedented time, not just for public health, but for our society and our world in its entirety. The last couple of years have made more visible than ever the multiple ways in which the social and economic systems that we have created affect our health and create and sustain profound inequities in health across races, social classes, countries, and neighborhoods. We saw this and continue to see this in the evolving COVID pandemic, of course, but we also see it in the pervasive and persistent health inequities that stem from racism and inequality. We see this in the ways in which environmental factors and climate change are transforming our world in ways that threaten our survival and increase inequities even further. All of the issues that we study in public health, that we learn how to act on and advocate for, are front and center in today's world. You have read and discussed and written about topics ranging from calculating rates to the impact of residential segregation on health, to the ways in which structures and systems shape health over the life course and across generations. You have acquired new knowledge, tools, and skills, but most importantly, you have brought your own life experiences to the classroom and to our school, enriching the ways in which we understand public health so that we can act with greater impact. You have embraced and exemplified three core values of public health. First, the critical value of truth and scientific rigor. Second, a commitment to social justice, equity, and inclusion because it's the right thing morally, but also because it's critical to improve population health. And last but not least, the value and the responsibility that we have to use what we know to make our world better for everyone. I hope that you leave with a sense that the health challenges that we face today, the loss of life, the illness and disability, the inequities, the overdose deaths, the environmental hazards, and so many others are not natural or inevitable. And to this list today, I must add the senseless mass shootings and the nearly 50,000 deaths lost to gun violence in the United States every year because of our failure to act based on what we know and what the data clearly tell us. All these problems are not natural or inevitable, and they will not be solved with thoughts and prayers. They are of our own making and can be undone if we envision a different way of organizing ourselves that places our humanity, the humanity of each of us, wherever we are from, whatever we look like, whatever pronouns we use, the place that places the humanity of each and every one of us at the center to promote health and quality of life for all of us. The intersecting crises of the pandemic, historical, pervasive, and persistent racial injustice, climate change, gun violence, and war, sadly, now as well, have cracked the door open just enough in some ways for us to glimpse a world of new possibilities, a world where things could be organized differently, where we as humans could leverage all of our potential together to create, enjoy, and live, to create, enjoy, and live our lives to fulfillment. The door is open just a crack, so stick your foot in it and don't let it close. You have four key tools at your disposal. You have your knowledge, your skills, your values, and your own history. And you have us and each other for continued support along the way. Use what you have and go forward to do what you have prepared for. You are ready. Congratulations, class of 2022. It is now my pleasure to introduce Komal Siddiq, who is graduating today from our school. She will address us on behalf of the undergraduate class of 2022.
Thank you for the introductions and greetings, faculty, family, and friends. I want to start by saying congratulations to the Dornsife class of 2022. Woo! It is for sure a moment of ample happiness and excitement that we are gathered here in person to celebrate all that we have accomplished and overcome in the past few years. We have finally made it after 4 long years of consistent hard work, sleepless nights, and early mornings. And we did all of this while transitioning from being in person to virtual to reuniting back on campus. We survived the peak of the pandemic. And though we are still living through it, we did not let any obstacle impede our abilities. If the past couple years have taught us anything, it is this. If a whisper isn't enough, then roar. If a stride doesn't cut it, then sprint. If sailing is not an option, then swim. We have built resiliency and unbreakable strength, all originating from us lifting one another up. We grew through the consistent effort and struggle. We managed to endure and adapt and become so flexible that now I can confidently say that we are more than ready to face the outside world. I want to highlight that this is not only a moment of pride and accomplishment for us, but this is a moment of realization as we have come this far due to the support and strength we obtained from each and every person surrounding us today. The accommodations provided by our professors, the emotional support provided by our advising team, the social support provided by our friends or family all played a crucial role in allowing us to make it this far. But this certainly is not even close to the end of it. We came to Drexel with such different experiences, cultures, and backgrounds. Each of us with our distinct stories, drives, and motives. But the one thing we have in common is that we spent the last few years studying public health with the focus ranging from disease outbreak and vaccination to domestic violence and child and maternal health care. The initiation of a global pandemic allowed the power of public health to resurface as we serve on the front line to ensure the proper functionality of all aspects of the community through such a crisis. As public health students and professionals, not only did we strive to address the issues regarding the pandemic itself, but we also made our very best efforts to consider the increased inequalities and exacerbation of pre-existing disparities due to the pandemic. We shed light on the differences in health outcomes tied to race, socioeconomic status, and other demographic factors. And with all that we have mastered through our 4 years at Dornsife, I sincerely hope all of our goal is to erase these differences one intervention at a time. Always remember, anyone can attain a degree, but not everyone can have compassion, and it is the combination of the two that makes a truly remarkable person. Whether you feel it today, in this moment, or 10 years from now, there is now embedded in you an overwhelming amount of endurance. There's no such thing as sink or swim because the former is not an option. you will find in yourself a drive to accomplish every goal you have set for yourself, and an undying vigor that will keep you going when you are feeling low. This is why our future is bright. The match has been struck and the flame is burning hot, and this light cannot be put out because we have made it this far, and we still have a long way to go. Now, our foundation is strong and our ambition is blazing, and that leaves us with no excuses to fail. We will step forth into the outside world, and we will make an impact and inspire those not far behind us. So, I leave you with this. How far are you willing to go to make a change? And where do you hope to direct those coming after you? Thank you.
Thank you, Komal, for those wonderful words, and congratulations on your graduation. It is now my pleasure to introduce our second student speaker, Tommy Ferrari, who will be addressing us on behalf of the graduate class of 2022.
Thank you, Dr. Diaz-Ruh, for your introduction. I am humbled to have the opportunity to speak on behalf of my classmates here today. I would first like to once again congratulate the class of 2022 and also to thank all of the faculty, staff, and loved ones who have made it possible for us graduates to be where we are today. We are grateful for all the love and support you have given us so that we may pursue our passion for public health. The class of 2022's experience at Dornsife was unique in many ways. The COVID-19 pandemic changed the way many of us went to school and changed all of our lives in too many ways to count. Before the pandemic, the average person wasn't familiar with what public health was. Within a short time, public health became the number one story around the world, and a new awareness of all the factors that go into health was starting to be discussed. For many, this unprecedented event brought to light the issues of racism, societal inequality, and the many social determinants of health that public health has sought to address for years. For some of us, the pandemic motivated us to enter the field of public health in the first place. For others, this only reaffirmed our commitment to creating health equity. Dornsife graduate students take many different paths before starting school here. Our students come from different states, countries, professional and academic experiences, and interests within the field of public health. This diversity enriches our community and allows for tremendous collaboration among faculty, staff, and students. While our unique academic and professional gifts and talents are extremely important, I believe that our shared values and beliefs are what make our community so special. Our school believes that health is a human right, and from this principle stems our goal of working to address health disparities and creating health equity. Not only do we have the skills to address public health challenges, we have the will and drive to do so. It is this passion and drive to make the world a healthier place that allowed us to write countless papers and study for exams, all while working and participating in internships, even when we felt like giving up. This combination of knowledge, skill, talent, and dedication is what has allowed my classmates to already make major public health contributions, with more to come in the future. While I am truly impressed by what our class has learned and accomplished already, our work is only getting started. Systemic racism, health inequality, and disparities in health are all still present, and there will be more new challenges to confront. We will be tasked with being fierce anti-racists in whatever role we are in and striving for health equity. While the COVID-19 pandemic will eventually, fingers crossed, subside, new infectious diseases and public health crises will emerge as they always do. We will be tasked with not only addressing the access to and the quality of health care, but also access to social determinants of health, such as food, housing, quality education, and countless others. We will need to work to bring together various stakeholders to solve the complex health problems our cities, states, and countries face today. It overwhelms me a little just to say all of that out loud, never mind the thought of actually doing any of these things. However, I feel confident that our time at Drexel has helped to prepare us with the skills needed, and that our shared passion for health as a human right will allow us to help countless communities and individuals achieve better health and health equity. Thank you all for your time, and once again, congratulations to the class of 2022.
Thank you. Thank you, Tommy, for those inspiring words as well. It's always so wonderful to hear our students speak. Thank you. And now, please welcome Gina Lovasi, Associate Dean for Education, who will present student and faculty awards and honors.
I would like to recognize graduates who have received special recognition and honors. The first is the Delta Omega Public Health Honor Society. Dornsife School of Public Health is home to the Beta Omega chapter of the Delta Omega National Honor Society. Delta Omega is a National Scholastic Honorary Society established in 1924 to recognize scholarship, devotion to public health principles, and outstanding service in public health. Members of the Delta Omega National Honor Society is awarded to those students in the upper 25% of their class academically and who reflect a commitment to excellence in the application and synthesis of public health principles, as well as to the protection and improvement of population and community health. Congratulations. Now, I would like to recognize those undergraduate students who have demonstrated outstanding academic achievement at Drexel, as reflected in outstanding final grade point averages. Students who graduate with a GPA between 3.5 and 3.7 are designated cum laude or with honor. Will cum laude graduates please stand? Those graduating with a GPA between 3.7 and 3.9 are designated magna cum laude, or with outstanding honor. Will our magna cum laude graduates please stand? Finally, I wish to recognize the recipients of the Dornsife School of Public Health Awards for 2022. Outstanding Promise, Matthew Wabwar, B.S., Yoselin Tercios, M.P.H., and Dustin Fry, Ph.D. The Outstanding Promise Award recognizes students who have exhibited great promise for regional or national societal impact, and accordingly for enhancing Drexel's reputation now and in the future. Mentor Recognition. Araya Amaro, B.S., Kathleen Ward, Ph.D., and Dr. Usama Bilal, Assistant Professor. The Mentor Recognition Award recognizes outstanding contributions of a faculty, professional staff member, student, or alumnus to the student body in areas of mentorship, advisement, teaching, or other service to the school. Junior Faculty Research. Dr. Ali Groves, Assistant Professor. This award recognizes a junior faculty member at the Assistant Professor rank pre-tenure, who with a primary appointment in the School of Public Health, in recognition of scholarly activity in the field of public health. Finally, the Golden Apple Teaching Award, Rabbi Nancy Epstein, Teaching Professor. This award recognizes faculty for excellence in teaching. Will all our awardees please stand? Congratulations to all of you.
And now it is my pleasure to introduce our graduation speaker today, Salim Chapman. Salim became Philadelphia's inaugural Chief Resilience Officer in September of 2020. In this role, he oversees the city's preparedness for the unprecedented challenge that the climate crisis presents to cities like Philadelphia and cities all over the world. He also ensures that the city is making progress towards goals laid out by the mayor's Mayor Jim Kenney's administration to create more resilient, equitable cities for current and future residents. As deputy director of the Office of Sustainability, he also works with the Environmental Justice Advisory Commission to engage citizens who live in vulnerable neighborhoods. The city also established the Interagency Working Group on Environmental Justice to collaborate with the commission in promoting practices, programs, and policies to advance equity. Before joining the City of Philadelphia, Salim served as campaign manager with Penn Future and as a policy and advocacy manager with the Sustainable Business Network of Greater Philadelphia. He is a native of West Philadelphia, and he received his Bachelor of Science degree both from Penn State and from Drexel, actually, and a master's from Penn State as well. Please welcome Salim, our keynote speaker today, to the podium.
Class of 2022, congratulations, you've made it. It is very humbling to be here with you to help celebrate this amazing milestone in your lives. Let me start, of course, by thanking Dean Diaz-Rue for inviting me here today and for her leadership at the Dornsife School of Public Health. I had the privilege of getting to know the dean and other faculty members and staff in the lead up to today. In one of the earliest conversations I had, I learned that many of you entered into this degree program shortly before the pandemic began or in the midst of it. And now that I have the opportunity to address you, I have to ask, why? Why do this to yourself? I looked it up, and Drexel has over 120 degree programs in their graduate practice alone, so there surely had to be an easier path. And honestly, I wish I could say that my scrutiny of your decision-making started today, but it emerged as a consistent practice shortly after my initial shock and confusion subsided. It became so routine that I was inspiring others to adopt the habit. I was discussing with my family one day what I would share with you all, and during this conversation, I openly posed a question. What is the relationship between sanity and genius that leads someone to enter their profession amidst this unprecedented period of public health? And almost immediately, I regretted saying this around present company. I regretted it because my mom was within earshot. And here's the thing about my mother. She is a fierce advocate for public health. Having spent her entire career in the healthcare sector, including more than a decade within the Philadelphia Department of Public Health. But this isn't the reason I should have been more mindful about my words. My mom is such the master of the verbal jab and parry that she would be the pound-for-pound champion if it was a boxing class. So upon hearing what I had said, she abruptly stopped what she was doing. She turned around and said to me, "You could spend your time searching far and wide for that answer, but I would suggest you be still and listen. The answer to that lies right there within you." It was the perfect quip at the perfect moment that all I could do was accept I had been outmaneuvered and concede, fair enough. The subtext in her well-timed retort was how reminiscent it was of the conversation that we had shared when I was considering whether or not to accept the role of Chief Resilience Officer. If you think back to August of 2020 with me for a moment, you'll recall how clearly we saw the complications that emerged when deeply rooted problems left unresolved for decades or even generations compound. Amid an unprecedented public health crisis, Philadelphia experienced a sustained period of social unrest in response to anti-black racism, the third hottest July on record, an economic recession, and a tropical storm that left significant devastation in his wake. So it is incredible how parents always find the most annoying way of keeping you grounded. Because no matter how inconvenient of a truth it was, I could not deny her correctness. Those close to me were surely questioning the relationship I kept between sanity and genius when I entered this latest chapter of my professional journey. But having been called to reflect on the similarities between us, I thought about what could be the common threads that run between our stories. Perhaps like me, you were inspired by the audacity of those who came before us. Those who looked upon an imperfect world and rejected the notion that their destiny was going to be influenced by things outside of their influence. Like me, you possess a burning heart and an unmistakable fury to do what is right despite temptations to take a more comfortable path. Or like me, you're driven by the heavy burden of survivor's guilt as you struggle to understand why the structural forces that diminish the life prospects of your peers opted to give you a reprieve. Regardless of what propelled you to this moment in time, I suspect that they are rooted in an intimate connection or attachment to the ongoing struggle for equity, freedom, and justice. Activism, after all, is a personal endeavor. I know that's true for me. Many of the predominant public health issues currently threatening our communities, environmental injustice, the inaccessibility of quality health care, violence and trauma, have all touched me personally. These issues have shaped my identity. So what makes me the professional I am is a breadth of experience that won't turn up on a LinkedIn profile. I understand what lies at the heart of building resilience because I know adversity. I've seen how deeply embedded structural inequities increase vulnerability to one-off adverse events. Now, I won't burden you with the details. After all, today isn't about me. Plus, we probably don't have the time. Because as Jay-Z once said, my story is too wide to fit within a line or two. But what I will share is that I grew up in West Philadelphia, not far from here in the shadow of this esteemed institution. And the circumstances of my early years taught me about the perils of navigating a system designed to fail you at every turn. Probabilities were such that it was much more likely for me to end up a statistic captured in a Drexel student's textbook than one day having the privilege to study here myself. And for the possibility of me appearing before you today, well, let's just say that wasn't a calculatable outcome. And while I stand here before you proud of the journey that has brought me before you today, I urge us not to fall into the trap of the comforting narrative of black exceptionalism. My story is not one of inspiration. It's a sober reminder of the need for meaningful structural change. Reckoning with these aspects of my identity taught me that the courage for social change blooms not from an expectation to transform the world. It blooms from the reality that you cannot hold the complexity of your own humanity, the struggles, the success, the pain, the joy, without unpacking the intersections of race, class, and place. What an uncomfortable exploration this can be, truth be told. Viewing personal experiences through the lens of privilege and oppression is filled with uneasiness and insecurity. And if it was not so essential to our collective future, I would suggest a different course. But the gaping wounds in our society that are becoming more visible every day makes it all the more vital that we step into the discomfort. Your achievement today merits this responsibility. As new professionals dedicated to reducing disparity and addressing the conditions that undermine vulnerable populations, it is essential that you have an understanding of how the distribution of power and resources manifests unequal social, economic, and environmental conditions. It was Joycelyn Elder, the first Black American to be appointed to Surgeon General of the United States, who said, "Health is more than the absence of disease. It's about economics, education, environment, empowerment, and community." You are now the keepers of this legacy. Now, even in this moment of joy, the weight of this responsibility might feel overwhelming. I imagine that's especially true given that you are stepping into this legacy during an unprecedented period of uncertainty and upheaval. Every day seems to bring a clearer focus to the far-ranging impacts of the country's two colliding public health crises, COVID-19 and gun violence. And then there are the increasingly visible impact of the climate crisis. Indeed, there is much to be anxious about right now. I'm overcome with uneasiness as well. And while I don't have a solution for you, I'll share what brings me comfort when my spirit feels heavy. While this social turbulence is uncommon, it's not unusual. From the Great Depression to the Great Recession, from Hurricane Betsy to Hurricane Katrina, our history is spotted with examples of disruptive events accelerating and amplifying persistent social harms. The pandemic, the gun epidemic, and climate change are merely the latest window into the intersecting crises of inequality, economic insecurity, and injustice. It further illuminates why we can no longer ignore questions like, what future are we stewarding towards? What are we sustaining? A structure that has included and marginalized generations of communities? Or are we steering towards something more equitable, more just? We ask these questions so that we don't once again discard the seas of opportunity in front of us. For generations, we've traveled through the winds of turbulence, only to end up right where we started. Place defined by a wide gulf between our stated ideals and reality. It might be difficult to imagine it now, but we could have ended up somewhere different. Different than where we are. This truth, along with the increasing daily reminders of the unsustainability of our current path, makes it all the more necessary that we bring our collective focus to making this leap into the future different. The portal to where we head next is up for grabs, and together we have the chance to seize it and set society's course towards its greatest vision of itself. We have the chance to address past harms and their lasting impact. We have the chance to correct present-day injustices. We have the chance to shape a future so plentiful in opportunity that merely achieving your life's aspirations doesn't make you exceptional. We have the chance to do all these things and more. I know this sounds like blind optimism. I can hear myself. I know it sounds like I don't understand the harsh realities of the forces of change or how powerful the inertia of the status quo can be. I know it sounds like I don't understand that even many of the giants who came before us had to compromise their vision. And let's be honest, it isn't as if I come before you with a track record that experienced deep confidence that this moment will be different. In the nearly 2 years that I've served as Chief Resilience Officer, the on-the-ground realities in our communities haven't changed all that much. So I wouldn't blame you if you're experiencing bit of skepticism. This leads me to perhaps the most valuable wisdom I have to pass on to you. Defeats and setbacks are inevitable. You'll even experience victories that result in unintended negative consequences. It's all part of the nonlinearity of social change. Still, even with this awareness, these moments can dampen your spirit, shake your faith, make you feel powerless. I'm familiar with the Cold Valley of Disappointment. I'm so familiar that I could call it home. And finding a way out of this landscape can be difficult, but radical hope has always been a reliable lifeline. I find radical hope in the long lineage of transformative changemakers to which we belong. We must remember that every step of progress has grown from a once uncertain future. Even the most influential moments of the past saw their visions and aspirations hanging by a thread. And still, they summoned the resilience and persistence to carry on. They carried on even as those around them questioned the genius of their methods. In the spring of 1963, activists in Birmingham, Alabama launched one of the most influential campaigns of the civil rights movement, Project C. Popular historical accounts now widely regard this as one of the turning points in the struggle. What those accounts don't highlight is that in the early days, it generated little support. Even the presence of Dr. King did little to draw the volunteers needed to sustain protests or to gain significant national attention. The effort was sputtering so badly that many thought Dr. King should accept defeat and lead a city. And still, they carried on. Even in their moments of despair, what the organizers of the Birmingham campaign understood, that the skeptics didn't, was that the mere audacity of the attempt was remarkable. Finding the courage to forge a future worth living, even amid almost certain failure, was the hallmark of change making. So, when you find the outcome of your pursuit in question, remember that you've already won. When offered the choice, you chose a future of radical possibility. You could have chosen a future of marginalization, despair, and hopelessness. You could have chosen a future stirred by the constant drift of inequity and injustice. You could have chosen a future ceded to fear. But you chose a future of your own shaping. And because of that, your genius is powerful and undeniable. Once again, congratulations and thank you.
On behalf of everyone at the Dornsife School of Public Health, Salim, I thank you for those wonderful and inspiring words. Thank you. It is now time to individually recognize all of our graduates assembled today. The names of our graduates will be read by Dr. Alex Eze, one of our Dornsife professors. And we ask that, out of respect for all the graduates, that folks remain in their seats until we have had an opportunity to recognize all of them. So thank you.
Marshalls. Please escort our doctoral graduates to the stage with their supervising professors to receive their hoods. Each graduate, thank you, Wayne Tran, sorry, we'll get it right. This is the first time in 3 years. Emily Brown Wader. Renee Joshi. Samantha Joseph. Katie Nelson. Jamele Lieberman. Nishta D'Souza. Caspar Voels. Valerie Raziana. Jessica Rust. Ariella Braverman Brunston. Sana Nassan. 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 Congratulations to all our doctoral degree recipients. We would like to recognize students who are completing both a bachelor's and a master's degree today. Students, please stand to be recognized. Marshals, please escort master's graduates to the stage to be individually recognized. Jiras Neza Khatib. Disha Opal. Gona Jacob. Sami Hamed. Ahmed Gobert. Jean Lang. Tracy Sled. Heather Don Santos. Isabel Velosa. Anna Davis. Shani Gadaka. Jordan Cobb. Aria Mooney. Olivia Rose Vesey. Kesia Brookway. Charles Mariela Scala. Sophia Rachel Figs Riley. Serge L. Screams. Abigail News. Lauren Ashley Echo. Katie Singley. Helena Rose Zeriel. Alexis Hantan. Zaharana Davood. Karima Faulkner. Gabriella O'Leary. Joanna Levine. Kanika Siegel. Lani Amy McQuicken. Sophia Agriba. Elena Proctor. Dara Edwards. Liam Edwin Roman. Kiera Warren. Holly Bowen. Niraj Narayan. Frank Joseph Cotton. Thomas Patrick Morris. Sejman Allen. Sarah Youssef. Susan Joyce Black. Allison Vols. Tia Camille Briggs. Yoslin Yasmin Tosias. Kevin Dogati. Pushta Shah. Stephanie Oluwatoliba Shosanya. Leanne Richard Gilbertson. Osman Diara. Ayla Mackenzie Chapman. Stephanie Catano. Juan Marcos Cotto. Chianugo Ezike. Chinua Azike. Veda Nashi. Kyle James Rose Bowl. Pascal Alim Valley. Emily Cousin. Erin Dornsife. Lauren Marie Fowler. Michelle Obasi. Kumal Siddiq. Thomas Ferrari. Ebony Pelzer. Talisha Kelly. Brittany Dunbar. Nicolette Santiago. Falson Ryan Sieber-Bonds. Abigail Brangill. Leanne Sarah Pliskin. Samantha Rose Harris. Colin Whitman. Yasmin Zaki. Naya Collier. Melissa St. Cloud. Lasalette Newton. Whitney Marie Grogan. Michaela Ray Brown. Katie Karen Anderson. Kiara O'Sullivan. Farah Khushid. Sarish Rashid. Jennifer Lynn Carson. Myra Cano. Esma Sharaf. Isabel DeRamos. Christina Branton McMillan. Chelsea Elam. Victoria Hazel Galogle. Denja Rezita Connie. Masuda Akta Mimi. Deborah Olubukola Awobajo. Keegan Brown. Wandia Muredi. Christina Collins. Cassandra Cariazis. Dima Abdullah Al Masood. Connor Kim Miller. Chizaram Bintu Sese. Tiffany Chani Hill. Gavita Naga. Noe Mati. Kylie Jenna Margaret Brinson. Lynn Pascal Gonnell. Elizabeth Margaret Waterman. Taya Edmond. Gift Chiagozian Jacob. Ashton LeGrand Rhines. Anna Fetin. Sarah Catherine Reed. Christina Teresa Dureja. Jessica Ann Green. Amanda Lynn Baguette. Kara Fisher. Peace, Chiemela Ozemena. Caroline Rosabel Huang. Oladoyin Mary Onawole. Barbara Diane Affleck. Corinne Janelle Davis. Amanda Biaka Badal. Linda Onesias. Inas Abutalib. Manji Ngweha Mulu. Lola Afolabi. Congratulations to all our master's degree recipients. Marshals, please escort the bachelor's graduates to the stage to be individually recognized. Amol Ahmed. Fabihan Naima Akunda. Amita Panika. Marvin Matthew Alexander. Bhagavi Sahu. Shaina Shakir. Jada Olivia Jones. Grace Margaret Ogdal. Matthew Wafula Wabire. Karian Ashley Edwards. Jacqueline Perez. Madeline Elise Perez. Fatu Jara Dabira. Albania Franguel. Congratulations to all our bachelor's degree recipients.
Well, let's have one more round of applause for all our graduates today. I wish I could speak many languages to congratulate everyone from all over the world that we have. I'll say felicitaciones a todos y a todas, and congratulations to everybody. I hope that can stand in for all the languages I can't speak. So, in this ceremony, we have paid tribute to the graduating class of 2022. Now it is the graduates' turn to salute those who have helped them along the way. I would like the parents, spouses, partners, children, loved ones, friends of our graduates to please stand so that they may receive the thanks they so richly deserve. Thank you. Thank you to all of you. I know I speak on behalf of all the graduates and all of us because it has been such a challenging time through which you've supported your graduates. So thank you. Now I ask the members of the class of 2022 to salute their professors and mentors at Drexel University. Will the members of the faculty and the administration please rise? Thank you for joining us today. This ceremony is definitely one of the highlights of the whole year, and I'm so glad we were able to come together for it once again. We're excited to continue the graduation ceremonies on Thursday, July 9th, with the university-wide commencement at Citizens Bank Park, which I encourage you to join us at 6 p.m., where all degrees will be formally conferred. When our ceremony ends, we ask you to stay in your seats until the graduates and the stage party have recessed. And once again, congratulations, felicitaciones, and onward.